Do you want to make sure it's coming through?
Just talk.
Yeah.
I hear you.
Okay.
Dear friends, I want to thank you for your presence with us this morning. Thank you for being here. This is an important moment. And I also want to thank our friends and family and others watching online. I know there's some from Ellisville Baptist Church and Riverview Baptist Church in Missouri, so we're thanking them as well. And isn't that just a testament to Georgine that her life impacted all over this country? And we're gathered here together, as you know, to grieve, but also to celebrate. And it's really hard to navigate that, isn't it? It's like you're holding both of these truths at the same time. We are grieving, no question. We're grieving because she meant a lot to us. She means a lot to us. And yet we're celebrating. We're celebrating her life. And we're celebrating the comfort that we know that her life was wrapped up in Jesus. And right now she is more alive than she's ever been. She is at home with her Savior, and we have that full confidence and reassurance. So today is a day of both grieving and celebration. And I'd like to begin, if you can join me, can we begin with a word of prayer? God, our Father, I praise you. We praise you. You, the author of this amazing gift that we call life. And God, we come together today and we remember and we honor and we thank you for a life that has been so precious to us. Our dear friend, Georgine. And Father, we ache from a void in our heart. It feels like there's a hole in our heart right now. And we lift up that sadness and that grief to you. And Lord, we're gathered here today, not only to grieve, but we also give you thanks for her. We're gathered and in this moment, we consider the brevity of this life, but also the assurance of eternal life with you. We're gathered to give thanks to you for the gift of life and the gift of family and the gift of friendships. And Lord, we ask that you would grant us in these moments the peace and the comfort and the joy that only you can give. That you would fill our hearts in this day, that you'd fill our hearts with love and our minds with sweet memories of Georgine. In Jesus' name I pray this, amen. At this time, our Grace City worship team will lead us in a song of worship. I invite you, if you'd like to stand with us and sing along, you may. If you'd rather stay seated, that's great as well, but we're gonna worship together.
And on that As we continue in this moment of worship, I'm going to invite you to be seated, but I encourage you, if you know the next song, it'll be on the screens. It's sung by our children's ministry here. Sing along and continue your hearts in worship this morning.
At this time, Georgine's granddaughter Lola, her grandson Max, and her in-laws Jerry and Darla Burt are going to come and encourage us with some scripture.
Romans chapter 8, verse 35. Can anything separate us from Christ's love? Does it mean he no longer loves us if we have trouble or calamity? Or are we persecuted or hungry? Or destitute? Or in danger or threatened with death?
Romans chapter 8, verse 37 through 39. No, despite all these things, overwhelming victory is ours through Christ, who loves us, and I am convinced that nothing can ever separate us from God's love. Neither death nor life, neither angels or demons, neither our fears for today nor our worries about tomorrow, not even the powers of hell can separate us from God's love.
This psalm of comfort is for many of us. It's one we prayed over, Georgine, and it's one Jerry and I say nightly.
The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters.
He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil,
for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup runs over.
Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
This reading is from the Gospel of John. Chapter 14, verses 1 through 3. Don't let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God. Trust also in me. There is more than enough room in my Father's home. If it were not so, would I have told you that I'm going to prepare a place for you? When everything is ready, I will come and get you, so that you always be with me where I am.
Sending in the dark.
We're going to have some of the family come and share some memories of Georgine, beginning with my friend, Georgie's husband, Jim.
Last night I had a crazy dream. Wish was granted just for me. It could be for anything. I didn't ask for money or a mansion in Malibu. I simply wished for one more day with you. One more day. Before sunset, maybe I'd be satisfied. But then again, I know what it would do. Leave me wishing still one more day with you.
Good morning. A long time ago, I told Georgine that when I moved on to the other side, that I wanted her to listen to that song. And never contemplating that she would go first. But this morning, I just wanted her to hear it. My words this morning are going to be so inadequate as I try to explain to you how much I love that woman. I dressed up for you this morning, baby doll, big time. How do I look? She often had to dress me. I would walk out in the morning, and she would go, don't match. So I'd go back in, and I'd do it all over again, and I'd come out, and she'd go, much better. Well done. Do you have your hearing aid in, she'd ask. She always accused me of not listening to her, you know, or not hearing her. But I heard every word. Every word. I may not have liked what I'd heard, but I heard every word. Inside the shirt, I'm wearing this morning, which probably doesn't match. I have this medallion, I guess it is, this little round thing I'm holding in my fingers. 30 years ago or so, on our 25th wedding anniversary, she gave me a watch. And I love that watch. And when it passed away, beyond repair, I couldn't bear to get rid of that watch. So I took the back of that watch off, which is what this is, because on the back of it, she had inscribed, "I'll love you till the end of time." And now, next to that, I've got her wedding rings. And I'll never take this off my neck. I don't care how many chest x-rays or CAT scans I have, when they ask me to take it off, it ain't coming off. You can take those procedures and stuff it, but this ain't coming off. As I look out in this sanctuary, this beautiful Gray City church that Georgine loves so much, and so crowded this morning. Georgine has a way of packing a nightclub, I'll tell you that. I guess the first thing I would say this morning to the gentlemen in the audience, some of whom are in my family and some are not, but I would make a request to you this morning. If you are fortunate enough to have your wife sitting by your side this morning or nearby, would you just please take a moment and hold her hand and tell her how much you cherish her and try to figure out going forward in every way and every day that you can, ratchet up your love for her. Would you do that? It means so very much. You know, the Bible speaks a lot about men and their responsibility in the family, spiritual leadership, example. In those respects, if I could put it this way, Georgine was a man's man. If a man wants to understand what God was talking about when he said all of those things about what men should be, all they need to do is look at Georgine's living and Georgine's life, and they'll figure it out. If Gigi were here right now, you know what she'd be saying? She'd be saying, "Stop it. Enough. Enough conversation about me and mourning for me. Enough. Just stop it." That's exactly what she would say if she were here. One of my sons told me the other night when I was having a particularly difficult time, he said, "Dad, Mom is sitting in heaven right now with her arms crossed, looking down at you, saying, 'Jim, get over it. Get over it.'" That's what she would be saying. And although this morning I remain busted and broken, I'm determined to get through this as best I can this morning. I may lose my train of thought. If I do, it's because my train is broken. I'm in a train wreck, is what I'm trying to say. Georgine's great love flows through three men of character that I know. My three sons, Brad, Jared, and Derek, whom she helped me raise. I don't mind admitting to anybody this morning that there have been moments over the last few weeks when I didn't want to be here anymore. And I'll be absolutely honest with you. It crossed my mind ways to make that happen. I consider myself to be a strong individual, but I must tell you that it crossed my mind. But what a cheap shot that would have been to Georgine and my family. My sons have told me numerous times in recent days, "We need you here, Dad." And they had my back. And I'm telling them right now that in the future I will be here for you and I will have your back. Is that a deal? I pray this morning for our grandchildren and great-grandchild. I pray that they are consumed with the underlying, undying love that Georgine had for them. Ashley and Everly and Georgie and Drew and Harrison and John and Teddy and Lola and Keegan and our adopted grandchildren, Ava and Max. Please understand the magnitude of love she had for you. And she recently stated to me when she was sick, all I ever wanted was to see them grow up. And she won't see you face to face as that happens, but she will see you grow up. Gigi's daughters-in-law, Kelly and Kizzy, share more than a special friendship, or shared more than a special friendship with Georgine. They were teammates in the circle of life and the circle of love around our grandchildren. Gigi, love you so much. And so look forward to being around you. Oh, she misses you, I know. Also in my family, when I was a little boy, I remember pulling my sister Karen around in a little red wagon, eating the mud pies that she made for me. Gigi loved you so much, sis. My brother Scott and his wife Lori have been with me during these days of seemingly endless agony, comforting me, and thank you, I love you. To my sister, Shelley, and my sister-in-law, Darla, what more can I tell you that I haven't already told you about how comforting you've been and how courageous you've been in helping me through this? I love you so much. My brother Jerry is a wise guy. A wise man is what I meant to say. His Faith in the Lord and the many conversations we've had over the last few days mean so much to me. We talked about God and Jesus Christ and heaven and salvation, and those conversations are in my heart, Jerry. Thank you. I love you. Jerry Caesar, my brother-in-law, he's not a one-off brother. He is my brother. And he is such an integral and important part of our family. I cannot explain to you what a friend he is, how strong he has been for me. And I thank you, my brother. I am so happy that you just live down the street from where I live. Otherwise, I wouldn't want to be here anymore. And then I just guess, and I'm almost finished, it comes down to me. On my journey through life, I ran into an angel on earth, Georgine. The blessing God gave me in having her as my wife is indescribable. Indescribable. The best decision I ever made was marrying her. And I tell her that often, but she'd say, oh, no, the best decision you ever made was accepting Jesus Christ. She'd tell me that often. And I'll never forget the joy in her eyes the day I asked Jesus Christ to come into my life. I'll never forget that. The joy in her eyes for me and accepting him. I've always prayed to be more like Georgine, and always in characteristic humility, she would say, knock it off. I don't need it. Knock it off. I always wondered where her strength came from. In large measure, I think it came from her mother, Skip. Skip was paralyzed from the waist down most of her life in a wheelchair after an automobile accident. And Georgine's dad, George, took care of Skip for many years. And when he passed away, I brought Skip in to live with us, and she lived with us for about 15 years. And all the years I knew that woman, I never heard him complain one time. Not one time. Georgine was exactly like her. That's where a lot of her strength came from. I love you, my darling, Georgine. My heart is broken to pieces. You're my dream girl. I know I'm going to see you again. I can't wait. I just want to thank all of you this morning for coming. She loved all of you. God bless you all.
This time, Georgine's sons are going to come and share for us.
So I just want to thank everyone for coming. I know Gigi's looking down from heaven, and she's very grateful for everybody that's here in this room to celebrate her life. I'm going to do my best not to cry, but like I said, it's a celebration of life. I'd like to include some maybe funny stories as well. So with that being said, I'll start off with kind of a funny story of when I was growing up. So I thought it would be, I guess, fun to sneak out one night. And my family, some of my family has heard this already. So Einstein, me, thought it would be fun to go out the front door. So go out the front door. I was gone for a few hours. I come back and the door is locked. So I have a couple of options here. Either knock on the door or I try to climb up the deck. So we had a two-story deck and then there was a door there. And I'm thinking, okay, if I can get up the deck, maybe it's unlocked. So I did it. I climbed up the deck. I don't know how I got up there without falling off and breaking any bones. But finally got over the rail, was huffing and puffing, got in. And the door was open. I was like, oh, thank you. So I got in, I opened the door, and I hear, Brad? And it was my mom standing behind me. And the whole time I was thinking to myself, if I would have known she was going to be standing there, I would have just knocked on the front door. It would have been a lot easier. My father mentioned my grandma Skip as well. So that was in part of my conversation as well. So when talking about my mom, she was the most unselfish person I've ever met. She always put people in front of herself. And a prime example, as he mentioned, was with Grandma Skip. She was a woman of faith, just like my mom. Like he said, she was hit by a drunk driver, paralyzed most of her adulthood. So she never complained, and I always said, you know, the apple didn't fall far from the tree. So, you know, she had to have a lot of things done for her because she was crippled. So my mom had to put her to bed and get her up and do all this stuff. So I think that's just one of many examples of her putting somebody else before her. I just want to say this too, that I can't tell you how truly blessed I am to have had her as my mother. We can pick our friends, or I say choose our friends, but we cannot choose our family. And when it came down to having Gigi as my mother, I can't tell you how blessed I was. She was a wonderful person. I just want to say this. I miss her, and I love her every day, and it's very, very hard. But knowing her faith as well as mine, I know she's in heaven looking down, and she's in a much better place. With that being said, I promise to keep it short, so I will never stop loving her, and I will always miss her. It will just be from a different place now that she is in heaven. I appreciate you all coming, and God bless you.
Hi, I'm Derek. I'm the youngest, and I called my dad this morning, and I said, Dad, I think I left my dress socks in Texas, and I apologize for the ankle socks today. And he just laughed, and he said, I can't find mine either. Only Mom knows where they are. So, Mom, we're off to a rocky start, but we'll make it. Her bonds and connections were so deep and wide, as evident by this room. And I don't know which family member said it, but Someone so aptly referred to her recently as Impact Woman. And I think that so accurately describes the way that my mom lived every day. She was an impact woman. She habitually gave and gave without expecting anything in return. She would frequently come visit us in Fort Worth, and on these trips, she would dedicate herself to some sort of home improvement project. And I don't mean changing out a light bulb and an air filter. She would literally paint a room, hang wallpaper. One day, I left for work, and by the time I got home, she had gone and picked up 30 bags of mulch, unloaded 30 bags of mulch, and spread it all throughout our mulch beds at the house. And when I got home, I said, Mom, I love, and this is at the age of about 73, 74, by the way. I said, Mom, I love you, but what are you doing? You don't need to do this. And her response was, I know I don't need to, I want to. And that was Mom, just so giving. But it wasn't just family. Around Christmas time, she would take all of us, and we would go volunteer at a homeless shelter, a food bank. Oftentimes, she would ask, instead of giving her a Christmas present, she would say, take that money and give it to somebody in need. Give it to a charity. Of course, all of her years of VBS mission trips, on and on and on. The adoration she had for kids was truly something to behold. Many years of service in the children's ministries. I have some very fond memories of the kids at First Baptist Ellisville coming up in waves, 20, 30 of them, sitting so quietly, listening to my mom deliver the word of God. And it was so special to watch. Mark 12:30-31 says, love the Lord with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind and all your strength. And love your neighbor as yourself. There is no commandment greater than these. And that's the way that my mom lived her life every single day. But don't mistake her kindness for a lack of competitive spirit. She was a very good tennis player. In fact, she whooped up on my brother Brad well into her 60s. And she had this unrelenting ability to place returns and ground strokes, making you run all over the court and just would wear you down beyond belief. But she was also feisty off the court too, wasn't she, Dad? Yep. We were, after Mom got sick, we were in the hospital, and she was having one of her better days. The day before, she slept most of the day, and my dad and I went in this morning, and she was up, she was alert, she was talking, walking around a little bit, and my dad had this notion to say that, you know, honey, I'm thinking about selling the boat. And just as quick as that came out of his mouth, she snapped back, no, you're not, you will drive me nuts. So he didn't sell the boat. As I, like many of you, have struggled with the, you know, the why. Why mom? Why such a good person? And realizing that, you know, we won't have an answer to that question in this lifetime. So I turn my attention to where, who, and how. Where is she? Who is she with? And how did she get there? And I take great solace in the fact that through the teachings of Scripture, that I can confidently answer all three of those questions. Dad, I want you to look at this room and look at all these people here that loved and cared for Mom so much and love you so much. We all love you so much. Mom, we love you. We miss you dearly. Keep your light shining down on us.
I just want to say, is this on? One other thing that I omitted. Brain fade. One of Georgine's great passions was children, as Derek mentioned. And I remember several years ago, we were attending, going to a fairly substantial Baptist church in the St. Louis area. And it's a church where she did hundreds and hundreds of hours of volunteer work with children, lovingly so. And the church was looking for a full-time staff children's minister. And she was on the committee that was part of the search. And the list of people they had was long and full of experienced, well-educated people in that line of work. And I watched the search go on from a distance and talked about it with her. And one day I was compelled to write to the pastor, our minister, and say, Georgine is the one you're looking for. And they said, well, okay, we'll interview her. I remember the day came for the interview, and I went to support her to the interview. And they asked all these questions about her faith and her salvation and how she got there. And questions like, do you smoke? No. Do you drink? No. And I sat there in a literal panic, hoping that they didn't put those questions to me. Because if they did, she'd never get this job. Well, thankfully, they didn't, and she got that job and served that church so very well for so many years. And every children's sermon, children's Bible lesson she wrote and delivered, Jesus' arms were around her. I watched her prepare that, prepare those messages hundreds of times at our table. Thank you.
Hi. For those of you I have yet to meet, I am Georgine's oldest granddaughter, Ashley. And let me be the first to tell you, I hit the grandma jackpot with my Gigi. Gigi was always a sense of home for me, a sense of comfort, and a breath of fresh air. From the home-cooked meals to the warmest hugs to always making sure all of her grandkids were having fun when she was around. I have so many fond memories of Grandma Gigi and the fun we would always have together. When I was younger and she and my papa lived in St. Louis, I remember at a very young age being able to go watch her play tennis. And like my Uncle Derek said, she was really good. And at the time, I didn't realize how cool that really was, but I do always remember her friends looking at her and telling her she was way too young to be a Gigi. She would take me to Six Flags in St. Louis countless times and to Looney Tunes Town to ride every single ride I could fit in one day. I remember her right there with me on each and every ride because I didn't just have a Gigi, I had my Gigi. Gigi was always involved in the church, no matter where she lived, and St. Louis was no exception. I remember her being in charge of a kids' sleepaway camp over the summer through the church, and I specifically remember I loved going because I felt like a celebrity because I was her granddaughter. I'll never forget how many kids over the course of a few days told me how lucky I was that she was my real Gigi, and they weren't wrong. I was really, really lucky. Going to the lake to visit Gigi and Papa when they moved was one of my favorite things to do. Going to visit meant Gigi's home-cooked meals for a few days and all the love you could handle. I remember every morning waking up, walking upstairs to a warm hug from Gigi, and of course, one of her famous bran muffins. I always loved when Gigi would travel to St. Louis after they moved to Orlando. This always meant family dinners and time spent with one of my favorite people. She came to visit after I had my daughter Everly, and I remember surprising her at my aunt and uncle's house and walking in and Gigi being over the moon excited to meet my daughter Everly. Over the years, Gigi visited numerous times, and we got to visit her a few times in Florida as well. One thing was certain, and it was that Everly had Gigi wrapped around her finger. When Gigi was around, she would let Everly wake her up in the mornings and let me sleep in a little bit, which to me was gold. She would always tell Ev when I woke up, "Remember, Everly, what happened with Gigi stays with Gigi." And that usually meant they had ice cream for breakfast, and she said yes to everything Everly ever wanted. When Gigi visited, she always took Ev on an adventure while I worked for the day, and I'll never forget one time when they went to the zoo. Everly came home covered in dirt, ice cream, and a little bit of candy in her hair, and Gigi telling me how sorry she was because the only thing Everly ate the whole day was candy and ice cream. I remember thinking that was just a day well spent with Gigi. Last July was the last time I would get to see my Gigi, and looking back, I'm glad at the time I didn't know that. I'll cherish the family vacations forever and the fun times we got to have with Gigi, laying on the beach or by the pool, relaxing with her. After every vacation with our whole family, I was always in awe of Gigi, and she was like the Energizer Bunny who never, ever quit. After we all left, we would get home, and I remember always getting a text a day or so later after she caught up on some sleep, and she would always say, "It's too quiet around here." Gigi impacted so many people's lives in such a positive way, not just mine and Everly's. She was the Gigi to the kids' grandparents who lived farther away or were no longer with them. She loved being involved in the church and getting to share her love of Jesus with those around her. She was the best of the best, and I am so very lucky that she was my Gigi. I'll miss the weekly FaceTime calls, the excitement I would feel when she would visit, and the sense of comfort she brought to me just by being herself, and so much more. This isn't a goodbye, Gigi, it's just to see you later. And as you would always tell me and Everly, you loved us a bushel and a peck, and we love you a hug around the neck, and always, always will.
She was waiting for us as we entered the world, ready to love us for infinity as only a grandmother could. Little did we know how tight our bond with her would be. It's obvious to say everyone needs a Gigi.
Milkshakes and muffins and Papa's favorite meatballs, hide and go seeks in the bedrooms and down the long halls. She'd swing us in the back and watch us as we climbed our tree. It's obvious to say everyone needs a Gigi.
"I love you a bushel and a peck," she would always sing, and prayed us over us at nighttime to be blessed by our King. She exemplified kindness and taught us how we should be. It's obvious to say everyone needs a Gigi.
Then she got sick and her goodbye was coming near. We didn't have enough time with her and it all seemed so unfair. But we know she'd tell us to smile
as we'll meet again one day and live life to the fullest and never forget to pray.
She crossed over to heaven, but in our hearts she'll always be. It's obvious to say God was ready for Gigi.
We are truly a blessed family. And Georgine had much to do with that. We had many, many years of some really fun family reunions. And it was clear during those family reunions that Jim and Georgine always had their song. They sang that song every year, over and over. Now, many of you in this room have maybe never heard of Sonny and Cher, but most of us, it sounds like, have. Jim and Georgine's song was "I Got You, Babe."
And as much as we'd love to attempt to sing that for you, we won't. They sang that song at every family reunion for years and years. The reason we bring this up is that we can take comfort in knowing that God is always there to guide and be with us during the happiest of times, like those family reunions. And when we are sad, like today, even though Gigi is celebrating like crazy.
On the Sunday that Georgine passed, Jim and my brother Jerry and his wife Darla, and Jerry and I, we joined Georgine in front of the television to watch Grace City online. And Pastor Thomas was teaching that day. And we thought Georgine was sleeping through most of the teaching. Sorry, Pastor Thomas. But as we talked about it afterwards, and Georgine spoke up, and she talked about the difficulties in life and how difficulties build perseverance and how perseverance makes us stronger in our reliance on God. And she also said this. She said, "Something good is going to come from my illness." Her confidence in our good God never wavered.
So here's our encouragement for everyone here today. We may want to say, "I got you, babe." But the scripture tells us over and over that he's got us. In the book of Joshua, the Lord spoke to him. In Joshua 1:9, he said, "Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. For Lord, your God, will be with you wherever you go."
So Jim and Brad and Jared and Kizzy and Derek and Kelly, he's got you, babe. For Ashley and Max and Keegan and Lola and Ava and Georgie and Harrison and Drew and John and Teddy and Everly, he's got you, babe. And for the rest of the family, he's absolutely got you, babe. And for all of our Grace City family here today that's so precious to us, he's got you, babe. And for all of Jim and Georgine's friends here today and across the country watching, he's absolutely got you, babe.
I want to thank the family for sharing those memories. The truth is, if we opened it up right now, we could spend days on end sharing stories. I know I just saw a lot of heads nodding. You're like, I've got plenty of stories too. And can I just encourage you to keep sharing those stories? Keep sharing those memories, those words of encouragement. Share them together. Share them with the family. Share them with Papa Jim to encourage them. And let's continue to honor her life. I was just thinking, there's this verse in Hebrews that says, though Abel has passed, his blood still speaks, and Georgine's legacy continues to live on. At this time, I'd like to draw your attention to the screen where we've attempted to capture just a brief glimpse at Georgine's life.
I got flowers in the spring. I got to wear my ring.
I told Jim this morning, back when we were planning out this time together, and Shelley mentioned wanting, we should have a video that celebrates her life, and I was like, oh, I'll do it, I'll put it together. And not thinking of what exactly that meant, instead of it, two things ended up happening. One, I will have I Got You Babe stuck in my head for the rest of my days. And the other is that I would end up spending time looking at these pictures over and over and over and over and over, and there'd be moments of just smiling and chuckling, other moments where it just hit me like a ton of bricks all over again. The loss of a friend. Man, what a beautiful life. So well lived. So much joy and a life lived to the full. And actually, even before that, when we had heard that Georgine had moved on to critical, Steph and I were just sitting down and looking through old pictures and kind of scrolling through all the different pictures of our family with her and other pictures of her life and just kind of getting a glimpse of those pictures. And then we came across this gem that just, to me, just so beautifully encapsulates her life. You got that? Maybe? Oh, you got to see this. Like that... That's Georgine, like, and that's the way, I mean, that's, Steph and I were talking, looking through the pictures, you know, the hairstyles change over the years, but the smile is just consistent in each and every picture, so quick to spot her from her smile. She lived big, she lived life to the full, she laughed hard. She'd laugh and then slap me on the arm. I'm like, man, I'm kind of weak over here, like. She lived big. She loved big. She did. It seemed like there was always enough room in her heart for one more, especially one more kid, to love and care for. And she always had a hug waiting. Every time. She just always had a hug waiting. I miss those hugs. But the most beautiful way that she expressed her love is not just with words, but with action. She served all the time. She served big. As Jerry said, like one of the most hardworking people I've ever met. I don't know if you know this or not. She had a couple of years on me, and yet I'm like, I'm worn out. Like I can't keep up. Every time I turn around, she's hauling something else around and just served. It was love, and it was love in action. And we talk a lot in our church. One of the things we talk about a lot is what does it mean to live and love like Jesus? And she did it, and she did it in such a beautiful way. And I get to share a few words to preach at her service, but in so many ways, she already preached her own funeral, her own celebration of life, in the way she lived, in the way she loved, in the way she served. My friend, Pastor Thomas, texted me this morning and said, hey, you need anything today? And I just said, just words. I'm like, what do you say? Well, what words do justice or capture the moment or convey everything when it's on your heart? And so I went back to these words, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. It says this, brothers and sisters and grandkids and friends and family and husband of 55 years, you have such a beautiful love story. Family, friends, family, gathered together. We do not want you to be uninformed about those who sleep in death so that you do not grieve like the rest of mankind who have no hope. And I just pause there. There's so much packed into just that verse right there. Brothers and sisters, we do not want you to be uninformed. The word literally means we don't want you to not know. So what's the opposite we don't want you to not know. Let's get rid of the devil. We want you to know. I want you to know. I want you to know. I don't want you to be uninformed. I don't want you to not know. I want you to know about those who sleep in death so that you do not grieve like the rest of mankind. We grieve. Absolutely, we're grieving today. We've been grieving. But we don't grieve like the rest of the mankind who have no hope, because we do have hope. Verse 14, and here's our hope. For we believe that Jesus died and rose again. And so we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in him. He goes on to talk about in verse 18, he says, therefore, comfort one another with these words. Comfort one another with these words. I don't remember, I was trying to think about this. I don't remember the first time I actually met Georgine. I don't. But somewhere between that first time meeting her and over the next days, weeks, months, and years of sharing life together, this person became not just a stranger in the crowd, but a friend and eventually family for my family, not just part of our church family, but like with so many others, including many in this room, adopting my kids, giving them a Gigi that they needed, and became family. I do remember, however, the last time I talked with her and the last time I was able to have a conversation with her. It was a few weeks before she passed, and Steph and I were talking, my bride and I, and we wanted to get over to see her. She was at the hospital here in Waterman, but she was going to be getting transferred, and we wanted to get over there, so we raced over after church. Steph got over there first and spent some time with her, and then we literally, I think, high-fived passing. She went home to be with, take care of our kids, and I walked into the room, and I just got to sit with her for a minute. And I found, which is typical, that I went to encourage her, and she encouraged me instead. Right? Big surprise. If you know Georgine, you're like, yeah, that sounds right. And we talked for a moment, and there was a kind of a quiet moment. We just both smiled. And she talked about Jesus, and she talked about hope, and she talked, and it was amazing. I remember saying, man, I'm going to fight like hell. Honestly, this whole time, I told Steph after she passed, I guess I was just in denial. I didn't know she would win the battle that fast. I didn't know she'd get victory that quickly. And so we're sitting there in this hospital room, and she smiled and I smiled, and I just said, "You're tired, aren't you?" And she just nodded. She's like, "I'm gonna be transferred in a little bit," and I said, "You need some rest now, don't you?" And she nodded. And I said, I would love to be selfish right now and spend some more time with you, but I know you need to rest. And so I went up and I gave her one last hug that I didn't know was going to be the last hug. And she closed her eyes and I walked out the door and I smiled back and I headed out. And here's the thing, though, is that's not the last hug. And I said something at the beginning that was untrue. I said, we've lost Georgine, but we have not lost Georgine. We know exactly where she is. And it's been stated clearly over and over. St. Augustine said these words, and I often think of them in times like these. He said, blessed are those that love you, O Lord, and love their friends in you and their enemies for your sake. They alone will never lose those who are dear to them, for they love them. And one who is never lost. And who is this but our God, the God that created heaven and earth? After she passed, my sweet little rye guy, who called her Gigi, my sweet bride was talking to my 7-year-old and said, it's okay, mommy, it's okay. I'm sad. But Gigi is happy because she's in heaven now. And he knew that. And it was not because that Steph and I tried to instill that faith in our child, but Gigi helped instill that faith in our child too. And Steph kept trying to figure out. She wanted to post something up and just acknowledge. And she kept putting it off, and she started writing it, and then editing, and then writing it, and then adding more, and then editing it. And then she went to post it, and it's like too many words. But I love this line. She said, "He knew you loved the Jesus you taught him about." Looking at her son, Rye guy knew you loved the Jesus you taught him about. So we're here today. We are here to celebrate her life, but we're also here to celebrate her faith. And I don't think she'd have it any other way. Revelation chapter 21 tells us, here's how the story ends. Revelation 21, it says, "He will wipe every tear from their eyes, and there will be no more death or sorrow or crying or pain. All these things are gone forever." There's been a lot of tears shed. They have been, they have been today, and they will continue to be. But I am looking forward to the day, that day when the tears will be gone and we will be united with Jesus and reunited with Georgine. And we're supposed to comfort one another with these words. And that's the truth of the gospel, and it gives us hope and it gives us confidence. It's a hope that doesn't disappoint. In John chapter 14, again, if you're just wondering, well, how has this all happened? John chapter 14, Jesus says, "Yes, I'm going to prepare a place for you. And here's what you need to know is that I am the way." And he gave his life for us so that we can have a way to be with God, with Jesus, with the Father, with him, with the Spirit forever in heaven. No more tears, no more crying, no more sorrow, all those gone forever. And that's the hope that we hold on to, sometimes with shaky hands. But it's the hope and the faith that we hold on to. And if you have never trusted Jesus as your Savior, I cannot think of a better way to honor her this morning than to tell you and to give you an opportunity to put your faith and trust in him. Now, that same thing, that same testimony that Jim was sharing earlier, so you can have that same certainty, confidence, hope that Georgine had that doesn't disappoint, and it's available to you, it's available to me. It was even available to Jim, so you know God's gracious. Love you, buddy. But I want to give you that opportunity. If you've never put your faith and trust in Jesus, if you're not sure, if you walked in this morning, you're like, well, I think so, but if you've never trusted Jesus, I want to give you that opportunity now. And the beautiful thing is the invitation's always open, but this might even be the moment. What good can come from this? She said, "I was confident, I was convinced that there's going to be good." Maybe the good that comes from this is that you, for the first time, your eyes are open and you're not missing, that you will know the truth of the gospel, the goodness of God, and the confidence of having forever with him. So I just want to give you that opportunity. If you want to, if we can just have a moment of prayer, if you can just close your eyes for a moment, forget everybody else in the room. It's the best news you'll ever hear. Is that Jesus loves you, died for you, conquered sin and death, rose from the grave. And if you're ready to trust him today, I want to invite you to pray this with me. It's not magic words, it's just an attitude of the heart, but for many of us, being able to put this into words has been helpful. So if you want to repeat after me, just in the altar of your own seat, in your own place where you're at, just repeat after me. "Dear God, I admit that I've messed up. I need you. I've done things in my life that don't please you. I've lived my life for myself. And I ask you to forgive me. I believe that you sent Jesus to die for me, to save me. You did for me what I couldn't do myself. And so right now, I choose to accept you, to accept your free gift of salvation. I put my faith and trust in you, and you and you alone. Jesus, help me live every day from here forward, following your will and your ways. Thank you, Jesus, for loving me and saving me. Amen. As we close our service this afternoon, Jim and the family would love to invite all of you to
to head out for a reception to continue on conversation and memories around a good meal in our commons area right out the back doors. For the children, we'll also be releasing some butterflies in honor of Gigi. But before you head out and spend time with each other, in honor of Gigi, she would love if you would go and be the church with everything that you have, everywhere, every day. The service is concluded. You may stand and exit in the name of the Lord.